Allow me to introduce very shortly. First of all, François, thank you very much for coming.
You're welcome.
For many reasons, first of all, I think all of us here at Forum, and also specifically myself, have an amazing, we're absolutely fan of what François does, and it's of course silly to be a fan, but I think what he does today as architecture, not so much as his architecture, is necessary. So for that reason already, we are happy that he wanted to talk. At the same time, if it would be just a talk about his work in the context as other talks happen, that would already be fantastic. But here, specifically, we wanted him to do exactly that, but in the context of what we call this semester Metropolitan Architecture. I already gave a lot of explanations about that in the last introduction to Christopher Haraway, so I won't repeat everything. But essentially, we do these four talks. We started with Christoph, we now go with François of Medin, and then we go to Oliver of Kempetil, and then at the very end is Fabrizio Balabio. So the thought here is that we try to, in one way or another, in a very oblique way, to touch upon what on earth could be high-tech, technology, machine, metropolitan architecture, the whole mix. So, not so much by asking them to do something specific, but just to be themselves. And we feel that tangentially we somehow approach to that what we are all together after in our studio, and we of course also hope that everybody else here simply likes what they see. So, François, thank you. Thanks again. We said machines, but that was just a concept title. We somehow thought that everything he does is machines. Anyhow.
Okay, thank you, Kersten. Yes, there was a hidden agenda, which was not even hidden, because I was asked to somehow speak about the machine. And I was very frank about it. I said, listen, I don't have time to prepare a lecture about the machine, but I have a lecture that is ready, and I'll see what turns if there is something... well, meaningful to be said about the machine. I realized, going through the presentation last week, that I did not have to do anything. Everything was a machine. So, and I wanted to start with this. This is a lecture that was given in foreign countries. And they don't know anything about us in foreign countries, which I always have to present my partner, which is Patrick Heiz, which you can see here in the back, the guy checking what I'm doing, kind of thing. But it sets basically the tone. We were asked by a magazine to actually represent, do our portraits within a setting defined by architecture, and our eight architecture offices were asked to do that, and out of the eight architecture offices, seven of them just posed in front of their buildings. I think that says a lot about our profession today, and we were the only one to somehow not to respect basically the rules of the game and say, well, we're going to do a montage somehow that is meaningful to us. I'm not going to say much about this image, it's totally secondary, but of course it engages in the question of our relationship to the machine, and also a certain idea about uncertainty when it comes to architectural ventures. So I will go through the presentation. It's very simple. It's a series of six or seven projects, and then we can speak about it probably in a discussion later on. I'm not going to make a point out of everything. It's a pretty long lecture. There are 136 slides. So I'm going to try to make it brief. First image, I mean, we stayed really close to the moon again. The reason for which I showed this is that I didn't really know how to call this lecture when I prepared it. But I knew one thing, that it had a lot to do with structure, infrastructure, and superstructures. And of course, there's a very clumsy title. I decided not to give any title. But the reason for which I present the house we built in Charbonnet under such a background is the fact that we were asked by a fashion magazine, which is again an issue about the contemporary condition that we're evolving in, asked by the fashion magazine to speak about architecture. And they were very clear about it. They said, well, you know, present anything. And I heard you're building a house in Charbonnet. Why don't present this house? And we told them, well, we can't do that because the house is still under construction. They said, well, then it's not a problem. Do a montage or do something that is meaningful about this house. And this is basically the picture of the house. I'm sorry for the contrast, I'm not so good. But it's a house with basically the primary structure. And what is interesting about this image is not so much that it's set on the moon, because I will tell you about why it is set on the moon, but it is primarily because it shows the structure as it is, and it is basically the house itself, because once the house has been totally finished, it really looked like the structure itself. In other words, we were trying to point out to the fact that the structure was the house itself and not an added value to an agenda that was stuck behind this ambition of, let's say, staging the structure into a landscape. In this case, we said, okay, well, because it's a fashion magazine, we're not going to try to be scientific about it. We're going to react as they usually work in those magazines. We're going to do a commercial, except that you're not allowed to do commercial for liberal professions in Switzerland. So we had a problem. We proposed actually to say we're going to reduce the presentation of the house to a cover page with a slogan. Some don't work with the same gravity, of course, you know, trying to touch also what was meaningful to us in the process of publishing to a fashion magazine, and it was refused. So we had to add a floor plan and a little description of the house, which was a shame. So, but this is basically how we would have liked to publish into a fashion magazine, which actually, for us, is an important topic, not the fashion magazine, of course, but the fact that architecture is being recycled now on all levels by the medias. No matter how irrelevant this might be in the discourse of the fashion magazine, how do you publish such architecture in those magazines? And this is how we did it. So the house is not set on the moon. It has a context. As you can see, it's also quite an extraordinary context. And I will simply spend some time describing the house. The house, as I said, is defined by a primary structure, which is two virandelles, poutre virandelles, which are bound together by a secondary structure. And basically this structure, as I said before, defines the whole house. You can see the house is a glass house, but it is not developed as a glass house, as the modernist glass house would usually be developed. It is set into four chambers, juxtaposed to each other. Do I have a pointer somewhere? Do I have a pointer? Is anyone... So the first chamber is basically the living room, would address the issue of the landscape. You can see the image. The second one from the right to the left would be the entrance hall in the kitchen and the dining room. You would have the main entrance hall on the third module with the visitor's room and the parental suite in the back. I insist on the fact that if I spoke about structure, I also mentioned the fact that it was the topic was about infrastructure. In this house, in order to, for architectural reasons, objective reasons, we thought it would be interesting somehow to keep the slenderness of the structure as the main expression of the house. And in order to do so, we'll see that in the cross-section afterwards, we had to basically exhibit every technical features. We had to compose with these technical features in order somehow to attain what we were trying to obtain with the structure itself. You can see here this view from the, this is a montage where you got three images brought together, but this is really how the house and the living room appears with this wonderful landscape stage. Well, you don't have anything to stage really, you just have to profit from it. And these view over the lake and over Vevey. And this would be the parental suite. It is to be noticed that these four chambers of these four houses, those four glass houses can work independently, but it can also accommodate some sort of an enfilade all around the house, a very traditional way of dealing with the way of dwelling. And this parental suite has transparent bathrooms and secondary features. And of course, it was a challenge for us to actually have the client, who were at the time 65 years old, to accept this kind of attitude towards their most intimate living spaces. We have to realize that these clients had spent most of their time in a barn, in a very old barn with 80 centimeters thick walls and very small openings. And they decided to spend their retirement into some sort of a steel house and a glass house. So the change of nature in their life is a massive one. And I think this is also some sort of a message. I think if one believes in architecture to a certain extent, it cannot do much. It would be a mistake to overestimate it, but it will also be a mistake to underestimate it. If one is to take seriously the topic of dwelling and housing for a villa, then it would probably have the ambition to change the life of the proprietor of this house. And in this case, it really was kind of a difficult process for them to accept this change of life so late in life. But now, 2 or 3 years after the house had been finished, they had told us that they had really been extremely happy about the change that had occurred them into the lab. This is the section, and we'll see why I show this section intentionally without the plot and the line of the terra underneath, because this is basically the house does everything in order to be detached from the terra. And they acquired this plot. It was 1,000 square meters, and when we built the house, we gave back the plot of 1,000 square meters. In other words, the footprint of the house is reduced to almost zero for a very good reason, not because of architectural ambitions, but they expressed very early in the process that they wanted to have an exterior space in order to be able to live outside in the spring. And if we had, because the plot was very narrow, if we had actually set the house all the way to the terrain, we would have left probably the terrain with a very small garden and something hardly usable as the way they were depicting their future way of living. And in other words, here we give a house without any footprint. Obviously, the whole terrain can be occupied by exterior dependencies and occupations. This is a side view of the house. I pointed out the fact that we had also to leave with a very expressive structure, a plastical one. That would be instead of a systematic one, as opposed to a systematic structure, we decided to opt for a plastic structure that would actually have this plasticity as the main feature of the house. But you can see here in the detail section how much we had to struggle in order to fit everything into the minimal depth of the slab on top, on the spear slab and the roof and the door slab. What you can see here, which is interesting here, is this steel part, which was for the first time used into a housing project. It's a steel profile that has been developed by ThyssenKrupp for parking lots, and it's the only steel profile now up to date that can carry beyond 515 in an economical way. So it's exactly the size of a parking spot, and it was the first time that ThyssenKrupp used it for a housing project, but it allowed us also to stick, of course, pipes and technical features in between the several elements. So it has a minimal amount of concrete. The most minimal amount of concrete here is set at 8 centimeters, and it allowed us to avoid to have a secondary structure between the main trusses of the Vierendel. Here also, I'll show you how the infrastructure is being played with. You got the structure set back from the climatic limits, and you've got louvers that can be actioned in a very specific way in order to ventilate quite accurately the house, because the house on the side has fixed glass, and of course it was a wish of the client to be able to ventilate these spaces, which is of course natural. And we found the solution to set actually those opening louvers behind the structure. You don't really perceive them, but it allows you, because it is set into an intermediate space between the two chambers on either side, and accommodated with also sliding doors, so you can actually choose to ventilate the house in a very accurate way, choosing to either ventilate only one room or two rooms at once, or even in a minimal way by closing the sliding doors and creating those niches where the ventilation would be more subtle. And actually, as it turns out to be, it works very well as a whole, and it is also complementary, to have to go back to the section here, to the fact that the four chambers here, the four rooms, and defined by the Vierendel structure, are being set on top of which there's going to be four basins, water basins, which allow relationship also with the landscape, which was also some demand from the authorities, because they said this is the first time we do a flat roof in this area. You're going to have to deal with the issue of the roof, and they said if you will grant you the permit, if you are able to engage in a relationship with nature. So they asked us to basically make a roof garden, and we accepted that condition, knowing that we wouldn't be able to do it. So we got the permit knowing that we will not do a roof garden, because the structure would not sustain it. So we had to find another way to deal with it, and what we did is that we did with a Belgian product, a resin that was stretched between the steel structure, which can raise the temperature, which can raise up to 80 degrees in the summer. And each one of these roofs, which four roofs, actually form a basin. You know, it cools down the house in the summer, as long as the water is not evaporated. It can be fed up either by the natural way through rain, or it can be also, you have also several nozzles that can actually feed those basins in order to keep the water at a certain level. And it cools down, the whole thing cools down the house during the summer. So it's not a glass house where you can actually, of course if it's hot everywhere. in the best insulated houses. But in this case, the ventilation system and the infrastructure that lies behind it actually works very well. You can see I was mentioning also this four glass houses working perpendicular to the main axis of the house, but you can see also that we would, through those sliding doors, be able to actually arrange the house as almost a series of enfilades in a very traditional way. Almost a very French way. You can see also the convectors, which are also Belgian, I need to say that, for industrial convectors, which are used, you know, to... there's lots of Belgium in there. And then, of course, and last but not least, the structure of the post, of course, and one of the reasons for which we decided the main structure to actually stretch out to the limit of the site was in order to free the space underneath the house, and not to create any obstacle between the tenant and the landscape and the house itself. So the house looks as far as possible for is a sustainable appui, and it has a problem as such because it is set so far onto the limit of the plot that if the neighbor decided to dig a hole next to the foundation of the house would probably collapse. So we had to afterwards, which is not shown here in the section, we had to bind and actually pull the two columns together in order to be sure that if the neighbor would actually decide to do something next to it, the house would not fly away with. You can see here in the cross section also something that was very interesting for us, and of course it's a bit, part of it is vanity, part of it is also a playful way of dealing with architecture, but we thought, okay, it's such a small house, 145 square meters, how do we do a monumental entrance? And we thought it would be interesting to cope it not only as a monumental element, but to cope it also with a functional element or something that would reveal as a sign the occupancy of the house. This is the house when it's not occupied by the owner. And you can see you can pull down the stair and somehow create some sort of little pavé in front of the house. You can unfold things. So this machinery is highly artificial in a way, but it stages its only connection with the terrain. In other words, once the stair is up, there's no connection possible to the house. And it would be a sign of the occupancy of the house. Of course, they don't use it that way, which is also, of course, a great joy to realize that people, once you've explained how such a feature would work, do not use it that way. Here's what they do in the summer when it gets real hot. At night, because you've got two entrance doors on either side of the staircase, they pull up the staircase halfway and then leave the entrance doors open in order to ventilate the house generously during the night. In other words, it's become a ventilation system while it was a sign of the occupancy of the house. You can see how charming the use or the misunderstanding or the misuse of an architectural feature, how exciting it can become. Okay, the next project is not really an architectural project. Galleria Alpina is basically a study that was... that we were invited to take part to a few years ago about something that is about to become very famous in the world because this is the longest tunnel in the world. And now, don't ask me whether it makes sense to actually now promote the connection between North and South. It seems to us that economically speaking, even politically speaking, the link between East and West would be more interesting nowadays. But nevertheless, there is this segment here that we've dug into the Gartenbasis tunnel. And it's going to be a 57-kilometer long tunnel, which is going to become the longest tunnel in the world. And they have this thing. You can see here how they start. It was interesting to us to actually understand how they start to build those things. Nothing new, technologically speaking, about this tunnel. In other words, this is not something that helps science or somehow anything interesting to move forward to become some sort of a progress. Every technology that has been used in this tunnel has been used before, and you realize that actually each country has its own specialties. For example, the South African are the best vertical diggers. They can mine vertically better than anyone else, and the Italian can dive. You know, they can dig horizontally better than anyone else. So you have a whole consortium of capabilities and. Faculties who come together in order to build this thing, but basically the whole world have partly built this tunnel. And what they do, they start from one side, they start from the other side, but that's not the only thing they do. They also start in the middle of the tunnel. Now, this is what they do. And the commission that we got was from the municipality of Sedrun, which is in the center of the tunnel. more or less, like one third of the tunnel at the end of Esfeld. And this is a municipality that called upon a series of architects in order to do something with a unique feature. Not only the tunnel itself, but we had the opportunity to visit the tunnel as it was under construction. It's an extremely interesting experience. You have to realize that the temperature at the level of tunnel oscillates between 45 and 65 degrees. And it's extremely hot. The condition, the working conditions are extremely, extremely difficult. And you can't hear anything because this is, of course, coupled with a massive ventilation system. So you have to walk around the tunnel following your guide with headphones because you won't hear anything that he says because it's too loud because of the ventilation system. And of course, the conditions of the temperature makes it hardly really appealing as such, because all the other architects proposed to go down into the hole and to reach part of the tunnel and to witness basically the train pass by, which seemed to us absolutely absurd because there's no real difference except for the temperature of whether you are actually 1 meter under the level of the ground or 1,000 meters underneath. What is unique about this is that the municipality of Sedun has tears in its eyes when it talks about the project, because they have a problem that a lot of municipalities have also in Switzerland, is that the young people leave the villages to go to the larger cities. So they have a shrinking community, and they say, well, we have something unique in Sedun. It's not so much the Alps themselves, but we have this hole, because what they did here is they dug a hole of 500 meters across the mountain and then dug vertically for 800 meters. You have a shaft of a 9 meter diameter wide section that goes down into granite for about 800 meters. This is the longest hole, vertical hole into a granite, into a mountain in the world, and they say, well, when the tunnel will be in service, we're not going to use this hole anymore. Do something with it. Provide something with provide a program with this hole so that we can somehow capitalize on this thing. And of course, the reaction is to take as an experience to take a lift and go down 50 meters per second as fast as possible, and to reach 1,000 meters below the surface of the earth and then watch the train pass by. We didn't really understand that, as I mentioned, so we proposed to do something else. And we mentioned machines. I mean, the machines actually here, in these cases, are extremely wonderful and very poetic in a certain way also. It probably, so the project revolves around this hole. What do we do with this hole? How do we make it actually perceivable from the outside? Because we didn't want people to actually get into that hole. So it has a lot to do with the original Switzerland, Urschweiz, as we call it. And of course, I'm sorry for the bad resolution. This wonderful landscape at a time where, in history, in Switzerland, which is often described as the oldest democracy in the world because it was founded in 1291, which is not really the case. The true confederation, as we know, the modern confederation, as we know it, of course, it's from 18 days back to 1848. But in the past, here's how we would communicate, because at the time they were also mentioning the fact that they would promote the Swiss exhibition around the Gotthard at some point in 2027, I think, something like this. And we thought it would be interesting to somehow cope with the history of Switzerland when it comes to communication. And in the past, the shepherds would call back and communicate between the different shepherds and different groups of stocks through the Alphorn. The Alphorn, before it had become so romantic, was a tool to communicate around the valleys and to create some sort of ecosystem that will allow the different shepherds to actually bring together a certain understanding about how they're going to deal with the several stocks that they were had to move around. And we thought it was a wonderful idea. It would also somehow bring us back to this idea of Narcissus, that we would deal with an idea of the echo. In other words, dealing with a historical substance on how to communicate between the valleys into such a landscape. And also promoting the idea of Switzerland as a self-appraising country. And here's what we propose. Into the tunnel, we propose to prolong the tunnel, which has not reached the level of the surface as it is nowadays, to prolong by 400 meters by our friends the South African, and then to make it somehow perceivable as the train passes by, it would trigger, and through the shock wave, the air particles would move up into a gigantic tube, which would turn into an the largest instrument there is today. So every time a train would pass by, you would not see the train, but you would hear the train pass by and develop this and then create an echo. It would be a time clock, it would be a sign, it would be revealing basically how it's based on, upon when it comes to history. And of course we discussed with people dealing with sounds, but they told us that to move air particles over a kilometer would be too much of a challenge. The shock wave displaced by the train would not be sufficient. In other words, we had to implement a device that would be triggered in order the air particles to be shot up all the way for a kilometer up, and then before the mountain can scream up and somehow be the witness of technology happening 1,000 meters below the surface of the Earth. So not really an architectural project, but a reaction to what the commission was about, and of course the staging of a certain amount of technological features. The Mont Blanc competition was a competition we took part 3 years ago for a new passerelle. I insist on the word passerelle because I think it's such a low ambitious project at first that we thought it could not be true. But they are planning, we have a lot of, you can see here, this is basically the last bridge. You got a series of bridge overcoming the Rhone, and this is, we're talking about this land right here, which is, for those who know Geneva, nightmarish infrastructure at the moment, because it's totally inept to what the demands for traffic is nowadays, but not only, it is occupied during the summer and most of the time we're by tourists and bikers and pedestrians and cars and public transportation all come together in a very all too small infrastructure to cross from one side to the other. And we thought, well, and this is the situation nowadays, and basically we had a plot, which I have to insist on, which was about 35 meters deep from the limit of the bridge itself, in order to build the passerelle for bikers and pedestrians. So the winning project did exactly that. They did really a passerelle which was about 5 meters deep, and we thought, well, this is really an opportunity to do something else than just a passerelle, or any engineering feature that would somehow be an objectual feature instead of an infrastructural one. So what we did is that we looked a little bit throughout history and see how the shore in Geneva had developed over history. You have here the first situation in 1848, and then the first 19th century intervention with the implementation of an architectural promenade stretching from the great parks around the Rade, and with the Jardin Anglais, which is here, a series of English gardens. And you can see here also the development of this promenade, which can actually stretch further beyond the limits that we show here. But what is interesting is that this promenade actually links what used to be private parks and now public parks, and will remain public parks. And you can see at the state here in 2013, you can see that there is only a missing link in order to complete this promenade. And we thought, well, then we're going to stay in this objective, trying to pursue this 19th century ambition of the promenade and to complete it fully, and simply adding a series of elements that would actually develop this promenade all the way along, which would lead to a promenade of about 12 kilometers. So what is this infrastructure? This infrastructure embraces the whole depth of the site that was given to us as an opportunity to react. And it develops a certain amount of features. We will see, basically, this is the layout. The first part of the bridge itself is really pedestrian. You have in the back the circulation for the bikes. So very clear splitting of the several elements of circulation. The main road remains as it is, and a pedestrian area on the other side of the sidewalk, as a sidewalk on the other side of the bridge. But this is not the most important feature. You can see that how this actually element will work as an infrastructural feature before it is a sculptural feature. And I will show you, try to explain. In Geneva, we have once a year a very ridiculous event where we actually blow in fire, in fireworks, about I don't know how many millions of Swiss francs, and it, of course, it gathers thousands of people. And what they do is they always implement temporary structure in order for people to actually look at this firework. And we thought, well, then with our project, they wouldn't have to somehow implement this temporary structure because the shape of the structure is such that it would be implemented as a feature in order to watch the fireworks. So in other words, this crossing from one side, from one shore to the other, is more than that. At first, it can also be used as a temporary feature for the fireworks and for the events that would take place around here. This is the first performative aspect I would insist on when it comes to this project. And then we realized, of course, as in many other cities in Europe and in the world, a lot of hua ob were actually being set along the shore of the river. This is the modern version of it, of course, the turbine hall. And by implementing a very low-tech gear system, we would actually invert, basically, the current of the lake and then create some sort of an artificial, you will see afterwards, an artificial monument. But by doing this, we would create a resistance that would allow to actually feed the bridge and part of its surrounding with electricity. It would work as a resistance. And then we were very serious about it. We even came here with... We talked with the faculty that was responsible for hydraulic engineering here at the EPFL. They were extremely excited about the project and said, well, this would definitely work. We would also make a test. We were also thinking right away to make a test on one that is scaled 1-to-1 in a different river. And they said, well, that would be fantastic to create this resistance at the end of the lake and then produce energy with it, which is what we did. So it would create energy. That's the second performative aspect. And in Geneva, we have this very nasty wind. I'm not going to teach you about this because everyone knows about this nasty wind that we have. But of course, because of the geology of Geneva, this can become extremely difficult to bear, and can reach also very spectacular effects during the winter. When the wind blows, it's almost unbearable to cross this bridge. I mean, in the winter, when the wind is real strong, this is really an experience that is highly unpleasant. And by staging this almost deflective wing onto at the end of the lake, we would protect basically the cyclists and bikers in the back of this monument this year. So it would act also as a performative, as a deflector of the wind. And of course, the main obstacle of all on this bridge is the traffic. And the traffic, we're not going to be able to struggle against the traffic as such from such an infrastructure. But what we could struggle against is the noise that is developed, and the noise and the nuisance which are actually developed by this bridge. And by doing this, by implementing a huge waterfall, we would somehow try to create noise as a louder feature in order to counteract the noise of the traffic. So this is the last performing act of this infrastructure, which appeared at first only as a surface, as a territory, in order to link the stage, in order to link the right side of the shore and to the left side of the shore, but it actually, as you can see, it performs on every level, produces electricity, fights against the noise of the infrastructure, and implements also facilities for the fairs that are taking place in Geneva during the year. And this is nothing new. We realized also through this engraving that in the 18th century there was also what you called waterfall in Geneva, at the back of Geneva, of course not at such a scale, but it was also interesting to us to somehow point out to the fact that this ridiculous, or whatever you want to see it, this water jet that we have in Geneva would have its counterpart through a horizontal waterfall that would be staged here at the limit of the lake. It was handed in 3 months after the tsunami in Japan and very badly received. Okay, Tennessee Lions Arena. This is another project. Before I speak about the project, I think I have to speak briefly about hockey. Not that I'm a big hockey fan, but basically, the reason for which I know that I want to mention the fact that this sport is probably as close as it gets to the Roman Games. I mean, it's a very violent game, which is also part of the game. Of course, it's played on ice. It's very sharp. You talk about steel, ice, cold, violence, and so on. And we thought, well, then there is a way somehow to stage this massive confrontation between two teams. Not to mention that each team nowadays has much, based on copying basically the American system. Now each team has its own emblem and in line. I don't know, in Zurich it's the lion, somewhere else the eagles, and somewhere else it's the basically fighting spirits always behind this. And we didn't take it as cynically as the jury might have thought, because they thought we were really offending them by doing this. We thought we're going to take this as a one-to-one feature of really what hockey is about. And I want here to point out basically how important it was to us also to implement the project within a certain context and with the infrastructure as most proximity, as the closest proximity. You can see here on top, you've got a parking lot. We decided not to place underground, but above ground, which was already a suicidal decision, because nothing now that concerns the house, or let's say our cars and automobiles would be set above ground, which was suicidal, as I said. We lost the project also not only for this reason, of course, but one of the reasons was this one. But we had very good reasons to do so. We were not allowed to dig beyond 3.5 meters under the level of the ground. So we thought then, you know, we might as well just place the cars above it and use it as a bridge above the expressways, which would allow the northern part to feed the site through this infrastructure, and would also allow the people and spectators from the northern side of Zurich to actually reach this infrastructure by ways of roofs, by some sort of skyways onto the site. You can see here, the plot, as ridiculous as it may be, is very, very, very small, probably way too small for such an infrastructure. And we realized that our criticism about the size of the site had been taken seriously, because later on, nowadays, the project is being developed without its addition with a volleyball arena. So it's not only just one arena. When we did the competition, it was two arenas, a volleyball arena and a hockey arena. And the main sponsor and investor of the project was the volleyball arena. And we realized that we were not really interested into this volleyball arena. We couldn't really cope with it because of the site, which was so small. So we somehow neglected a little bit, which was part of the reason for which we also lost or didn't get into consideration for this such a project. We considered the volleyball arena as secondary, and here in this case it doesn't develop any representative architecture in itself, but creates also a link between the infrastructure of the parking lot and the main arena, which would host 12,000 spectators. There's another feature which would be interesting to see here. You can see how the infrastructure interests us. In this case, I want to point out to the fact that the infrastructure here is being led through a ramp. And I mentioned it was really as close to the Romans. I want to mention something else here because people seem not to take that seriously. What is at stake when building a stadium or developing a stadium, at first, before the image actually that is being produced, is how to separate the flows of the people. Between VIPs, between journalists, between host team and the visiting team, there cannot be any contact. They're really white gooses, and we have to somehow control them. It was said really very, very precisely in the brief that you have to separate the spectators, the fans of the visiting team, from the fans of the hosting team. And you can see here that the infrastructure basically is set in such a way that it circles an area where the visiting team is being dropped off and has no contact whatsoever with the rest of the stadium itself. In other words, there is a constrained and a contained way of dealing with the flows of the visiting team, and this is basically secured by the fact that the infrastructure, you cannot see that because you would have to see it in 3D, but the infrastructure slowly tips down into the stadium and allows no trespassing of this infrastructure once you're being dropped into this area. It's a fully secured area where no one else can actually access except for the people having the authorization to. So the infrastructure here being extremely central to the way also the flows in the stadium actually work. In the section, I want to show how the machinery also helps us to solve the issue of how to distribute such a stadium. Our first understanding of the stadium was that they wanted a lobby of about 4,500 square meters on the ground level, and then we realized that if one were to think very pragmatically about what a stadium is about, the only place really, or the only level, to be more accurate, where potentially 12,000 people could ever meet would be the ground floor. And the ground floor would therefore be at its widest on the ground floor level, and then coming up, you would literally distribute the rest of the people along the stands, and each one actually attributed would be attributed a series of stands. In other words, the footprint of the house needs to be as its widest on the ground floor, because that's the only level where potentially, I'm not saying every day, but potentially 12,000 people, the maximum mass of people accessing the building, would find themselves around. And instead of 4,500 square meters of a lobby, we gave them a 10,000 square meter lobby. And all around the two ice rings, which you see here, there's a first ice ring placed here at the level, sub-level. This is the ground level here. You have the main ice field is being hovering and works as a bridge on top of the other ice field in order to contain the object as small as possible. And then what you can see here is that you don't use necessarily stairs or anything like this. You use, of course, you get stairs between the escalators, but our main idea was to have the people brought up not on top of the structure or at the lowest level of the structure, but right in the middle of the arena. So everyone is being brought up by means of escalators, machineries, into the middle of the arena, and then is being distributed either north or south of this intermediate platform, distribution platform. Here you can see one of our homage to one of our masters, Vancouver's. We had a problem that we, because the main arena, you can see the superimposing of the two arenas, one would be for LNB, the other one for LNA, so the first team of Lausanne, of Zurich. And we placed basically the locker rooms in the lower part of the building, and we couldn't ask the players to actually walk with skates for about 12 meters in order to reach the level of the ice. So what we decided is to implement a huge platform onto which the whole team could be placed, and they would basically be staged as gladiators, hovering up and being shot up into the main arena, and the first visiting team being the first one to appear would of course be a very dramatic entrance for the players. In between, on the ground level, the players meet the press at the level of this platform and can be stopped, and then the press is being invited to actually engage into discussions with players and trainers and so on at this intermediate level, at the level of the training ice ring, which you can see here. Another feature which is interesting in hockey is that for ones who have been attending a hockey game is the atmosphere there is. Oh, I have to come back, I'm sorry. I'd like to go back to play. So, if you've attended a hockey game, one of the main features is the noise. It is nothing like a football game or any, not to mention a tennis game where everyone is supposed to be silent. But there you can barely hear yourself into when good conversation takes place. And we thought it was a wonderful feature actually that was really quite specific to hockey, hockey arenas. And we thought, well, we're going to try to stage this thing. And in order to do so, we decided, because once you realize that when developing a stadium, everything is being set by rules. The angles of the stands, the size of the seats are defined, 55 centimeters between 2.5 centimeters between each seat and so on. No, you realize very quickly that your influence as an entrepreneur is very limited. And the only influence you can really have is of course the representative image that you want to promote with your project, but also the corner issue. How do you solve the corner issue? You can round them up, you can break them down, but we decided to get rid of the worst spot, the worst seat in the stadium, which are the corner ones, and in order to implement and stage this noise, this extremely wonderful feature of hockey, this overwhelming sound experience, to open the corners in order the whole arena to vibrate and to resonate from its atmosphere. In other words, not just the arena, the whole program itself would resonate from the noise created by the main arena. And in order to do such, making it even more more appealing, we decided to build a whole stand out of like a ship, basically. You will see the final image. It's an 8mm steel sheet, like the ones they use in order to build ships. And you can see here the four corners being open and allowing this relationship, this intense relationship, this traveling of the sound into the whole arena, and not to really constrain it and contain it only into the arena, a representative arena only. here are the two friends that you've seen before, still fighting on the ice. And this is basically the appearance of the building itself. This is an existing building. This is an Arctic oil platform owned by Gazprom. As we handed in the project, we realized that Greenpeace had done an action onto this platform a few days later. And we had seen basically the opening team trying to take hostage this wonderful object. Of course, it's been edited, you can see that. But basically, this is what the image we want to achieve in order to question, almost in a reverse, retroactive way of designing what such a potential, based on the our understanding of what the demands for such an area should be, that is the 12,000 people on the ground floor and then being spread around the rest of the building. In this case, we question on how, almost retroactively, we could question such a shape and see what potential it would have in terms of performative aspects. I mentioned also the fact that each team had its own animal to promote a certain image. And in this case, the idea was to leave this helicopter platform and to place an old lion and take the old lion out on game days as a sign of the activity within the city, because they didn't want any loud appearance. We thought, well, then when there's game day, they take the lion out, and you could see from the expressway and within the city, you would know that the game would take place in a very American, very American way of dealing with the show. Of course, nothing like this will ever take place in Switzerland, but it was it was a lot of fun to actually develop it.
Too much special detail.
Too much special detail. Exactly. Okay, and then I'm going to finish with two projects that are set in Lausanne. The first one being the competition for the EPFL Pavilion that took place 3 years ago. For the, just, I don't know, it's probably being built at the moment, right? The project by Kengo Kuma is currently being built. So I'm going to go through the project so you know most of the conditions. At first, they shortlisted a certain amount of architectural teams, offices, to develop what they call pavilions. So... and they were actually sent out to three main pavilions, an art pavilion, Montreux, what they call the Montreux Jazz Lab. I insist on the Montreux Jazz Lab, laboratory, as a rhetorical feature, which we thought would be had to be taken seriously, which apparently is not the case. And then a welcome pavilion where they would actually exhibit, basically, the advance in technologies being developed within the school. And reading the program, I realized very quickly that they didn't really know what they meant by pavilions. And by doing so, we questioned, historically speaking, what pavilions meant. And we went through some sort of a quick etymological research and realized that pavilions are many things when it comes to architecture, but not only. So the first thing that a pavilion is, it's a corps de bâtiment servant d'accompagnement à un bâtiment plus important. In order to resume that, I could say, summarize it, in other words, a pavilion is a secondary building. And if it's a secondary building, there is obviously a primary building. And the compound of the EPFL, the primary building, makes, you know, there's no mystery about the primary building. The largest pavilion is that of the Rolex Learning Center. And it was important for us to point out to the fact that our pavilion, or pavilions, would not somehow compete with the image of the Rolex Learning Center. It was not everything to become but another icon on the compound. So it's a secondary building, and it had to remain as such. The other definition tells us, it appears first in the 17th century, it's a petit bâtiment isolé situé dans un jardin ou un parc. In other words, the influence of a pavilion is larger than the limits of its own body, and is always set into a larger compound than the limits of its own body. And it was very important to us to see that if we were to be addressing the issue of the pavilion as a serious matter, we would not consider the limit of the plots as it was given to us. I will show you what the plot was, but to consider the whole compound as basically our playground. First problem, of course. And then in the 19th century, acoustically speaking, is the extremité évasée d'un porte-voix. In other words, it's a transmitter. It's a transmitter of sound, which also was very interesting for us because the main pavilion being the Montreux Jazz Laboratory. It's not only a transmitter in medicine, it's also a receiver. You can see the ambiguity of the program defined by such a term. And it's a receiver at Anatomico Paris, Pavillon de l'Oreille. It's the pavilion of the ear. And last but not least, it's also, when it comes to maritime or language, une pièce d'étoffe hissée sur un navire pour indiquer sa nationalité, la compagnie de navigation à laquelle il appartient, ou pour faire des signes. In other words, it's a sign. A pavilion is basically those five features, and that's what we consider as the main program, not really what was given to us, of course, with respect to the square meters and so on. But we question actually the accuracy of such a program, and in such a way also question the general accuracy of programs when they're set into architectural competitions. And we decided to take this, the etymological understanding of the World Pavilion, as our program to be developed for the pavilions of the EPFL. We were invited to think about technology, not only because the EPFL is a technological school, but also because the main client of these pavilions, is not the EPFL, but the Montreux Jazz Festival founder, Claude Knops, who passed away 2 years ago. And we had the chance to visit his chalet above Montreux, in which is full of technology. And basically, you can go everywhere in every room, even to the toilet, you would have a stereo system and a television. And everywhere there's something being set as a technology. He's a technological freak, and he loves gadgets. And we thought, well, then, is this really the question we would be dealing with? Are we going to be staging technology? And we realized very quickly that technology would become very quickly obsolete. That's one of the very feature of nature of technology, that it becomes obsolete very quickly. And we didn't want our buildings, our pavilions, to become obsolete. So instead of dealing with technology, we decided to deal with the law. A general law of physics that would be still valid 100 years from now, in order to bypass this obstacle of obsolescence. Would be not programmed in that way, but the obsolescence that is bound to the nature of technology. And this is basically the speed of sound in a given medium. This is something we would like to stage in our project. With also the discovery that by implementing a certain research or developing a certain research around materials and geometries and curvatures and so on, you could depict a certain amount of effects that will be then spread around the compound. And we found those wonderful examples of acoustic mirrors. For those who know a little bit acoustics, and you must have known because you've studied that partly in physics, there's a very attractive way of dealing with those acoustic mirrors. You can whisper into one end and basically hear the other one speaking at the other end, 100 meters away from this beam of sound waves. And while you are in between those two sound waves, you do not hear anything. You are only able to perceive the sound, the quality of sound, in a very accurate way as you are facing the focal point of such an acoustic mirror. These acoustic mirrors seem to have been not only staging a natural law, but were taken seriously as a way to deal with air defense between the two world wars. The British were extremely worried the German would actually attack Great Britain, and started to make some research about how to listen to the sky in the early 20s of the last century. They were extremely serious about them, as you can see here. It actually worked. They couldn't really make the difference between a pigeon crashing into a tree or a bomber, and it became totally obsolete when they discovered the radar, so they abandoned the thing, but they were extremely serious. Look at these guys. And this is my favorite. And they abandoned those features, but nevertheless, they left also behind a wonderful piece of architecture, those totem-like objects, that would be like gigantic ears listening to the sky. And we decided it would be actually kind of very interesting to use these totemic elements in order for the sound to become the common, let's say, harmonic feature on the compound of the EPFL. We'll come to that later on. And then we also realized that because it was sent into a technological school, it had a lot to do with how to promote or transmit knowledge. Claude Knob was in the 60s, as weird as it appears to be nowadays, the CEO of Time Warner Cable. And as you can see on Time Warner Cable as a logo, what is interesting to see, not that I'm fascinated by any graphic elements at all, but by the content of it, it's an ear and an eye. And if you were to consider seriously the transmission of knowledge within a school, but also outside of a school, one could hardly do any transmission of a certain knowledge without the ear and the eye. So the ear and the eye being really the most primary senses in order to be able to transmit a certain knowledge. And these ears and these eyes would then be developed into what we research about biometric. And I'm going to read briefly this text. An ideal biometric is universal, unique, permanent, and collectible. This means that each person should possess the characteristics that is universal, and no two persons should share the characteristic remain unique. The characteristics should not change, become permanent, and they should be easily presentable to a sensor and quantifiable, that is, collectible. I think in this short text, the definition of what a biometric is, you can see basically what our mission was, to work with universal laws and laws of physics, basically staging also totemic features for each one of the pavilions as unique characteristics. These characteristics should not change over time, thanks to the physics laws that we're going to stage, and it should be easily presentable to the sensor and quantifiable. In other words, it would need the knowledge of the whole school about material, physics of acoustics, and so on, to be brought together as a team, not only with the specialists of architecture, but brought together into a multidisciplinary group of people working on those pavilions. In other words, the project is not possible without the knowledge being set and developed within the school ground. It was not our way to deal with architecture as being demiurge of the architecture, but to be able really just want a chain link between those different specialists that would be able to develop the project. And curiously enough, it was even true, we realized that also through these biometrics, we could actually investigate about what the identity of a site, or let's say an identity of a person when it comes to a biometric here, staged in 19th century. For a very long time, the ear pavilion has been the most specific part of a body part. Even real twins do not have the same ear pavilions. And it is still considered as one more relevant feature to actually an imprint, to do an imprint of an ear pavilion as of the finger. It is more relevant and more you can be more accurate about the identity of a person. It was abandoned, of course, afterwards when we found the studies about DNA. But this is what we'll be doing, the series of ears and eyes in order to stage a certain harmony within the compound. This is the first pavilion, it's a welcome pavilion, this huge acoustic wall being set actually on the edge of the esplanade being nothing but an open plaza towards the landscape, but we thought it would lack some urbanistic quality to it because of its opening towards the landscape, and by building this wall we would create a real piazza with very specific features around it and create a new definition of what this piazza would be. On one side you would have the piazza, l'esplanade, and then on the other side you would have this esplanade that we now call the esplanade, which is nothing else than just an area where an event can take place. It is not foreseen as a definition of a program, but it's only a place, a void onto which a definite event could ever take place. In this case, that's the meaning of the two brought together of the two images by Jeff Wall, stumbling block and a hunting scene, where basically into an awkward, or let's say an urban environment or a suburban environment, some event takes place, a totally unexpected event takes place. The main pavilion being the Montreux Jazz Lab laboratory, and then as I mentioned earlier in the presentation, we took laboratory as a very important feature. Again, we were very critical about the fact that they named it laboratory, but what they wanted is a cafe and a restaurant. So we didn't really understand what they meant by laboratory, and we decided to turn the pavilion into a real laboratory, a laboratory for sound. And one of the main features onto which you can really influence the sound would be to actually have an influence on its volume. And in this case, in a last homage to almost fossil energies, and we decided to use the reference of a gasometer, which would be able to actually develop develop a certain amount of features, one of them being actually a change of its volume. So the laboratory, the real laboratory for sound research, would be actually this space here, which can be accommodated, you will see, in different features. And underneath, you would have the cafe and the restaurant. And again, this platform that you've seen before in the ice hockey arena, where basically rock bands could take place and make a presentation of a concert. But this is not really the main feature. I would like to also insist on this image, basically here. You can see, and it's a critical point of view, of course, it was not understood that way, about what the nature of architecture is nowadays. And especially next to the, in immediate vicinity with such an iconic building as such as the Rolex Learning Center. You can see here that the rock band has disappeared from the stage. And we did it on purpose. There was not that there was on the original picture that there was any rock band, but of course here Balelec takes place once a year on this compound. We thought, well, this would be typically an event where architecture could be staged, and it was a bit critical because we thought, well, we're going to erase the rock band because here nowadays what seems to be the iconic feature would be more or less the architecture itself. In other words, we wanted to be critical and say, well, now we're not even promoting the image of a rock band, which would be idealized, but the architecture tends to be also becoming some sort of idolatry. And in that sense, we try not in a perverse way, try to become iconoclast about the architecture image that we were trying to produce. This is how the machine really works, the gasometer. You can see here a several layering of limits, climatic limits, which you can then develop. And then by doing so, you would change the volume within the laboratory, and which also would allow on top of this laboratory to take place, we would find also a huge difference. You can see one last feature about this gasometer. On top of it, you've got the main transmitter. You will see what kind of purpose does it serve. This transmitter can rotate in all directions and is being set as the main pavilion onto the compound of the EPFL, and would allow to actually reach its own goals and targets onto the compound and create some sort of a harmonic factor through music, which would then be also some sort of an irony onto a technological school. You can see here the platform being set underneath the laboratory of sound. This is the art most polemic pavilion. This is the art pavilion. We thought then if there is to be an art pavilion for a Swiss art collection being financed by the Confederation, then it might as well take place in the most artistic feature of the compound, namely the Rolex Learning Center. And then we took it seriously. We said we're going to be very respectful about it. It has nothing ironic about it. We said we're going to grow from the ground. This building has no really context with its underground, no real relationship. And the pavilion itself develops itself as almost a landscape feature in between one of the main courtyards of the Rolex Learning Center, which is, you all know, a completely abandoned corner in this building. Nothing takes place programmatically, but not only programmatically, also students seem not to cope with such a gigantic courtyard where nothing really takes place as such. It's a wasted space, and we thought, well, then we're going to try to activate it by implementing a certain kind of a pavilion within this courtyard. This courtyard, as you may know, is not a perfect circle, but it is so large that no one really realizes that it's not a perfect circle. And in order to reveal that oddness of the geometry, we thought that by implementing a perfect circle, a platonic shape within this ovoid form, we would reveal the tension of the form itself, the morphology itself. So the distance between the edge of the Sana building and our building, or our pavilion, which is not really a building, actually reveals the true nature, the geometric nature of the Sana Rolex Learning Center. You can see here. And of course, what you can see here, the main transmitting building. This transmitting building would rotate and then project sounds at a certain amount of decibels, which don't need to be really loud. And then you would perceive basically the music that was being played in the laboratory in the Montreux Jazz Lab around the compound, if you were to be actually crossing the focal point of these acoustic mirrors. In other words, you could actually walk around the compound, not hear anything, and all of a sudden, for a matter of 2-3 seconds, hear really what's happening 500 meters away from it. And acoustically speaking, it's a system that works. It stages, of course, a general law of physics, so there's no question about it. In 100 years, if they were to still be implemented onto the compound, the system would still work. And it was to us also important to somehow also counteract this technological aspect, this obsolescence of the technology, up to which, of course, the EPFL works, but quite seriously, by saying, well, it would embody somehow a certain understanding of the ruin that would come about in 150 years, and say, well, then the last homage to the fossil energy will also be staged through a combination with the staging of a general law of physics. This is basically the compound. You can see here the Montreux Jazz Lab as a center feature. This was the site that was given to us. This is basically the Kengo Kuma project.
And we decided to consider the site as the whole compound. You can see here, objects are being set into strategic points on roofs and parking lots, and we turned the whole compound into a sound park, basically here. And by developing research onto materials and sound effects based on morphologies of these totemic aspects, you would either concentrate the sound or spread the sound around a given surface onto strategic points of the compound. And last but not least project, I would like to speak briefly about the MCBA project, which was developed for the new Museum des Beaux-Arts in Lausanne, a competition in 2011. And it was an important project to us, not because of its metropolitan, character, which we found extremely interesting, of course, but also because we thought it was the opportunity to say something about our ways of dealing with also representation and images and so on. So we took the project extremely seriously. We thought it was about time to actually state something when it comes to competitions in Switzerland. And this is basically the plot. You can see the plot nowadays is being is a private plot owned by the CFF. So it's not a problem to which you can really meander or walk around. This is a private plot, and it's basically occupied mainly by a series of hallways where the locomotives and several parts of the trains are being repaired. And this hall here, you can see in the center, which was called the Hall of 1911, is protected. It's a protected object, but we question that protection again in a suicidal attempt to redefine what architecture should be, that is critical. We said, well, then this building has several features. One of them is being set up the urban tissue as it is nowadays, and as such works perfectly. Mm-hmm. But secondly, if we were to consider this plot as part of the city, it would only create an obstacle. And thirdly, and finally, we thought that the building qualities as an architectural feature were not big enough in order to be kept as a protected element. So we questioned that, and we decided to erase this building and create a completely new situation in the center of the city of Lausanne. I said we wanted to be critical not only about historical substance as it is nowadays, I've mentioned, but also about how to represent things. So I would like to go directly, almost in a didactic way, try to describe what we tried to do. There's basically a series of drawings, which you are doing as students also, but you will be doing also as professional practitioners. A drawing is nothing else than a scale representation, if we were to actually summarize what a drawing is. And the drawings are extremely clear about what we're trying to promote. In this case, instead of doing an object for a museum, which we would really be tired of, we decided to actually implement a new infrastructure into the city of Lausanne, which would be an extremely rare opportunity in our Western world to actually to build a new street. And in this case, we actually prolonged the Place de la Gare into a street. This would have a certain amount of features, and you could see here in the cross-section, what we're interested at first as such was this infrastructural aspect of the site and of the project itself, avoiding the object again. Of course, developing an iconography that would actually allow us to understand what was public and what was not public in this compound, but also implementing a series of prosthetic elements, developing also the infrastructural aspect of such an area. In other words, you can see we're using every bit of space in order to stage across a combination of walkways and stairways and escalators in order to bring to a better, to a more efficient way the northern part of the city towards the southern part of the city, and also enhance the connection between the eastern part of the city and the western part of the city. In other words, this crossing of the infrastructure became central to our understanding of the site. On the ground floor level, you do not find any part of the museum. Basically, it's occupied by activities and restaurants and secondary features. But you can see here on the ground floor, which is interesting, is that there was an answer to not keeping this historical locomotive hall, was to say, well, then instead of keeping really the built substance, which would also keep the function it was around this building, that is, it was mainly infrastructural, and what we said is that what we're going to be doing as a Denkmalpflege, so to speak, was to actually keep the spirit of it, that is, the infrastructural space. In other words, the street that we create is being surrounded by a minimal architectural feature that will allow this infrastructural space to remain present as such and refer to the past function and occupation of the site as it was before. In other words, this infrastructural space has to remain the central space of the whole urban tissue. You can see here this infrastructure is developed around the site, in between the site itself and the object, and is being fed by several prosthetic features linking the north and the south, the east and the west. on the sub-ground level, which foresees the future development, and the underground level of the main station in Lausanne, which we developed in the up to 2030, I think, as the main feature, as main development of the underground level of the train station, we foresee a development in the way that we can actually link the future development of the train station with our main street. In other words, the main street of the museum, or this new street that we implement here in this urban context, would be set not at the ground level, which is set nowadays, but half sunken, in order to have this direct link between the development of the underground level of the main station with the commercial activities placed in our project. You can see here also the analogy with the Basilica, floor plan, and you see through the section, and also the museum will take place, sorry for the bad resolution, not on the ground floor level, but on the upper floor level, which also would account for the reference that we use in our images, as we will see later. Another thing that was extremely important to us, because the museum itself is a series of the collection of the Musée des Beaux-Arts is not a great one, it's not a pathetic one, but it's not a great one, and it basically, we were not really interested in questioning the layout of such a museum, the Beaux-Arts, such a conservatory, almost reactionary way of dealing with the museum. And we said, well, it's a series of galleries, the way we actually know galleries in a typical traditional museum. So the typology of the objects itself, or the museum itself, was not our center of interest. But as I mentioned, the infrastructural connections within the city and in the metropolitan area. Another thing that is, of course, unavoidable when dealing with the city of Lausanne is its relationship with a certain topography. Unfortunately, you cannot see that on this image, I'm sorry. But you can see the development of the northern part of the city as a series of layers on top of each other, implementing a certain reality about the topography. And by actually looking at the other way around, you would see the Alps. In other words, by simply showing two long sections, one looking up and the other one looking south, you would basically have a full understanding of what the topography and the issues are when it comes to topography in Lausanne. In order to pursue that presentation of the projects, as I said, we talked about scale drawings, scale representation through drawings. I'd like to speak about images and illustrations, and in order to briefly introduce this, I have to read this short text. It's very short, so you don't have to worry about this. Husserl speaks of a proto-geometry that addresses vague, in other words, vagabond or nomadic morphological essences. These essences are distinct from sensible things, as well as from ideal, royal, or imperial essences. Proto-geometry, the science dealing with them, is itself vague in the etymological sense of vagabond. It is neither inexact, like sensible things, nor exact, like ideal essences, but unexact, yet rigorous, essentially and not accidentally inexact. The circle is an organic, ideal, fixed essence, but roundness is a vague and fluent essence, distinct both from the circle and things that are round, a vase, a wheel, the sun. A theoretic figure is a fixed essence, but its transformations, distortions, ablations, and augmentations, all of its variations, form problematic figures that are vague yet rigorous, lens-shaped, umbelliform, or indented. It could be said that vague essences extract from things a determination that is more than thinghood, which is that of corporeal reality, and which perhaps even implies an espiritual. The question is not so much whether we fully understand what is being said here. I don't think it's that complicated, but it's, I think it's important to, let's say, try to see the difference there is between a certain historic reality and the reality of today's reality of certain objects, and that between this historical reality and the reason for which it led to such a building in history and for which such a building is being used as it is nowadays, between those two extremes there is a whole series of realities that we want to explore. And in order to do so, we consider the project not so much, of course, an idealist project, but as it is said here, this unexact feature that is rigorously inexact, but able to actually promote a certain understanding and a certain position within a given context. And that's what I would like you to keep in mind when looking at what is going to come now. Let's start with illustrations, which is actually now what architects are doing every time they're doing a competition. They're producing illustrations, and we could describe, based on the text by Gilles Deleuze and Félix Guattari, which itself is based on Husserl's philosophy, illustrations are objective senses, and let's do this exercise into seeing how these images were actually built up. Here's the illustration of Galleria degli Uffizi, the legend corresponding, of course, to the description of what the object being depicted on the image. Kersten Geers, the Galerie des Machines, la Gare Centrale, la Grande Galerie, here shown during the war, not as a cynical gesture, but of course to insist on the fact that what's relevant to us was the layout of those galleries and not the artwork being hanged on the walls. The Mannheimer Schloss Zimmerflucht, the Enfilade of the Mannheimer Schloss, USS Ronald Reagan, and the Alps. These would be the objective essences, and each image and legend is really bound on a very pragmatic level to its content and to its depiction. In the course of the process, in the process of developing the projects, certain images are raised to the level of epitomes, which would be close to what we could describe as ideal essences. In other words, this is not the Galleria degli Uffizi anymore, but the knowledge, the trade, the forces, the place, the space, the order, the form, the nature. Brought together as a very pragmatic way, they would form images that would be nothing else than inexact essences. In order to point out to what I mean by this, we need the reference of William S. Burroughs, which worked, of course, on a rhetorical level and semantic level onto a similar notion, the ease of identity. You are an animal, you are a body. Now, whatever you may be, you are not an animal, you are not a body, because these are verbal labels. The ease of identity always carries the assignment of permanent condition to stay that way. All name calling presupposes the ease of identity. This concept is unnecessary in a hieroglyphic language like ancient Egyptian, and in fact frequently omitted. The definite article the contains the implication of one and only, the God, the universe, the way, the right, the wrong. If there is another, then that universe, that way, is no longer the universe, the way. The definite article the will be deleted, and the indefinite article a will take its place. As an exercise, let's do it. Instead of the knowledge, it will become a museum and a department store. A structure and a context. A scenography and an ophelon. A morphology and a landscape. Bound together, they would form what we called proto-images, that is, inexact essences, rigorously inexact, but providing us with a certain understanding of what the project was about. Interior, we called it interior, because, not to blur again the understanding, but because the quality of this street, which corresponds almost exactly to the proportion of the Uffizi, had the quality of an interior, of course, to the facade of the Kersten Geers ground floor levels. And, of course, with the information that the museum itself would not take place on the ground floor level, but on the upper level, as it is in the Uffizi, linking also the eastern part with the western part of the city. An infrastructure, referring to the Galerie des Machines as a morphological study and not as a structural solution. An exterior, because of the always constantly changing condition and relationship with the exterior of the galleries with its exterior. One's the street, the other one's the Place de la Gare, and again the landscape, and again the street again. In constantly, during the round trip of the exhibition, a constantly changing relationship with its exterior features. And the superstructure being also revealed in a relationship with what super means in Latin, that is something that is beyond what you see at first sight, something that is or further in distance. And in this case, of course, the sculpture terrace would deal with the issue of the landscape being set on the other side of the city of Lausanne. I thank you for your attention.
I have a question. Yeah. I remember this sort of little story about this house by Charles and Ray Innes, no? Mm-hmm. Apparently, you know, there was a first version which was, in a way, much similar in relation to the site to your to your solution, no? So the house was turned parallel to the slope,
yeah,
and it was suspended, no?
Yeah,
and then the story was, which I really didn't believe, that Once the material, so the steel was already on the site, he said they decided to
do it in steel.
Do a completely different project, no? So in a way to do house which was in two volumes and on the terrain, no? And I mean, as much as I follow, no, your explanation that in a way they wanted more terrain, no, and in a way the plot was small and so forth. Each time I look at that house, and I think it's in a way not a minus, I think that you simply wanted to make it like that. No? That I mean, when they are.
Yeah, well, you got the answer in the question,
yeah.
Right? I mean, you are insinuating that we wanted the house that way, and basically all the explanation that comes about it or around it is being said or applied afterwards. First of all, it's only half true, and second of all, we all do that. So I even think this is necessary not to promote an architecture by really giving the real reason for which that led you actually to such a design, because basically you're not going to be followed. And I actually addressed this issue. It is not true. This is really what happened. I mean, of course, the house, there's of course a certain intention behind the house. I'm not going to hide the fact that everything is mechanically, you know, engendered through the fact that we have to cope with this terrain and they didn't want to have a garden. Of course not. But it was one of the main features of the terrain is that it's extremely sloped and it's a very small terrain. And they still wanted to have a garden. And they asked us even when if they should buy the slope. They stopped and they said, well, listen, can you still make a house where we're going to have a garden and so on? So it was really a consideration of them that was really central to them. They did not want, that's one of the reasons, of course, for which also we accessed the house with this in the middle of the house and not in the back of the house or anything like this. But the irony behind this is that this main entrance with the staircase coming up and down is actually, when it comes to legislation, is a secondary entrance, because it would not be accepted because it's outside of the building zone of the plot. So the main entrance is through the toilet. Can you imagine this? I mean, they gave us the authority to build this house as the main entrance through the toilet. And they accepted it. They said, well, then if that's your main entrance, then fine, you know, enter through the toilet. And the other one was just you know, totally secondary feature, which became totally central, of course. And of course, I could imagine, let's say, I understand what you mean, there is a manipulation, but I think an architect is a manipulator. At first, and he's manipulating the demands of a client, he's manipulating the life of a client, he's manipulating a budget, he's manipulating a site, he's manipulating legislation. As I showed here, the staircase has to become secondary in order to be accepted, in order to become the main feature, one of the main infrastructural features of the house, it has become totally set aside. That's a manipulation, right? It's the same thing when we presented the project to the authorities for the permit, when we applied for the permit. I mean, as an elevation, you don't see that it's a rectangle. No one opposed. No one even wrote a remark about the thing. Now, when they saw the thing arriving, because it was built in 2 days, and everything was prefabricated in the mountain in 2 days, then they were shocked. Then they really complained. And I remember being on the side, and every day people would stop and complain or be curious about it. It's not always about complaining. You see, we're not that romantic that into adversity we find our freedom. But very often it seems that this is the case. And it remained the only example of flat roof in this area. And we still nowadays receive phone calls from our colleagues in building in the area and say, how did you get to do the flat roof there? And say, I'll tell you one day. There is no way. Actually, the main reason for which we were allowed to do a flat roof is because the site has such a topography that we would accept the house, even if the ground level was to be set onto the level of the ground, onto the second level, through the roof, right? And if we were to respect the legislation, the house would have such a tip roof at a height that everyone would complain about. And we said, listen, we can't come into the house by a tiled roof. There's no way. We have to be able to walk on it. And that they accepted. So, of course, it's a little bit of manipulation. And in your question, you seem to want to hear, yeah, but come on, you wanted to do it. Of course I wanted to do it. I mean, you know, there's no doubt about this. But there are reasons behind it. And then later, I have to point out that something that we opened, you know, this book by about Mies van der Rohe in America, and I came across a sketch I didn't know, which is exactly the house in Jeldam.
I know, but that's the same. Yeah. That's the same sketch, because yeah. The Eames story goes that they wanted to make the house based on that sketch of me.
Oh, then and I didn't know the thing. Yeah. And then people said, "Well, you copied it." That's it. Even if it were copied, there's no problem with this. It's a fantastic encounter.
Oh, you're here on the right of this. It's okay. But I mean, talking about technology, because of course you can also say, I'm sorry, I use a little bit, technology.
Course, yeah.
There's this very deep fascination, it seems, for technology. Mm-hmm. Of course, you helped us very much by showing yourself in your capsule. But I was wondering, I was at a certain point a bit surprised that you were seeking for an argument of survival here in the Lausanne campus competition. So you said, look, I want to build a building which survives longer than 100 years.
Well, it was a bit vanity at the same time.
I'm fascinated. And of course, I ask this a little bit in relationship to the studio topic, in a way that kind of dance around high-tech, which is currently happening. Mm-hmm. And of course, one of the main issues today with technology and steel, let's say, in general, is that it's hard to sell, right? Mm-hmm. Because everybody say, look, that's kind of... your house will look good for 10 years, and then you'll start to paint it like the Eiffel Tower or something.
Yeah.
I mean, how are you with that? I'm just curious. I mean, I have similar
questions. Well, I think there's two separate questions. I mean, there's the nature of technology, which we wanted to criticize as something that becomes obsolete very quickly. Mm-hmm. You know, as much as I'm fascinated by technology, I'm not a geek. Mm-hmm. That is, I have no fascination, for example, for an iPhone or anything like this, or something that helps us in our life. I use it as a tool, but I have no fascination. Mm-hmm. I'm much more fascinated, for example, with what the industry can do. Mm-hmm. The industry can do things that we are not allowed to do as architects because of security, insurance reasons, and so on. This fascination there is almost very naive and nothing new. It's almost a modernist fascination for what technology can do as such. Mm-hmm. And then when it comes to steel, you have, of course, this is an issue in Switzerland. You know, this is a very, very rare steel house in Switzerland. You know, and you're not being taught also in our schools in Zurich, in Lausanne, and in Mebrisio to how to deal with steel. I mean, you witnessed that when we did the commission last summer. But it's like this in our education. I mean, we first built this mass and this contribution to solid architecture and so on. But people tend to forget also, and some people also get nervous about steel. First of all, because it can hardly be used as a structural element, as an expressive element, because it always has to be cladded around for security reasons. In this case here, we're allowed to do it because it only has two stories. Beyond two stories, you have to clad it, which is, of course, a shame, of course, in the case. We're facing the same kind of issue nowadays with our project in Zurich, where one of the columns, I would like them to be out of steel, and we can't make them out of steel because if a truck comes in or if a fire gets is set, then you know the building does not collapse as a resisting object, but of course damages the facade and so on. So for you know you're on the assault on all sides when it comes to steel manifestation in Swiss architecture for obvious reasons. Is that and then the other thing that I think is really weird is that people forget about one thing is that steel is a recycled product up to 98%. Mm-hmm. 98% of what is actually constitute steel as a building material is a recycled material. In other words, in order to deal with steel in its long life cycle is much easier than to deal with concrete. So if we were to think almost on a populistic level of how to deal with those materials, steel is much more appropriate than concrete.
And then on a more personal level, is there a certain nostalgia for say 1950s modernism or American railway buildings, technology from let's say turn of the century, 19th century.
What I'm fascinated about steel is that what it can do compared to let's say corn material, which has other advantages of course, and the fact that it's an assembly, and this assembly has to be tectonically dealt with. And this tectonic of the assemblage is an extremely interesting one. I pointed out to the fact that this house, I remember one architectural historian coming to the villa and saying, well, of course there's something of Mies in there, but there's something radically different to Mies, is that Mies works systematically. He develops a system onto which is based all his design. And in our case, we work plastically. That is, you know, the Virondelle as a RHS 30x30 profile is a plastic feature, not a systematic feature.
I think Mies is more plastic than you now.
Well, it exists also in the multiplicity of the corners it develops, and so on, the flexibility of the system, what it can do. There's also almost an ideological part in Mies, on the Mies side, which he, you know, when he developed these courtyard houses made out of steel and so on, he foresaw something that did not become true, is that the prefabrication of every housing unit, which also there was very, you know, much in the air at the time in law school. And I think this is partly due also to the discrepancy there is between his cultural background as a European central and all of a sudden coming into a country where everything takes place as an El Dorado, where everything is possible through technology and through... And then he sees that almost as a reaction, you know, the spark takes place there. And it's very naive because he also pointed out himself that he remained the old German guy all the way to the end of his life. He could barely speak English. He was an inner person. His architecture, as much as it was fitted to appropriate to the new context he chose, as much as personality, remained really a European, Central European feature. Mm-hmm. Which I think the fascination, let's say the fascination for me is being able to actually overcome and bypass, or let's say cope with this kind of a new material to be expressed in an almost systematic way, is a certain fascination, exerts a certain fascination, as opposed, let's say, for example, to the only social and combination that that Corbusier developed. And for example, I'm feel closer to Mies. Not that I don't admire Le Corbusier or anything like this, but I feel closer to Mies because to me, I mean, if you look at a Mies building nowadays, you could feel that it was built a year ago. And if you get too close to a building to Corbusier, you realize that it's, of course, it's really an imprint of its time, ideologically, but also constructively, and everything that deals around it. And that Mies is definitely a classicist, and classical equals modern because it travels through time. And that's my fascination. Well, this is something we discussed also. And I think the fascination for steel...
My own fascination for steel. Yeah. But I think I'm quite aware of the fact that there's a strange nostalgia also in our work. In that. Yeah. I mean, there's a kind of the bolted steel structure that's not exactly technology of today. Eh?
Yeah, no, absolutely not. But also like this... You know, like for the stadium, to have the audacity to present like a whole stadium made of steel plates built like a boat... And this is something that is almost unthinkable in Switzerland. Mm-hmm. And as part of the context, the cultural context, it's just unthinkable. This is really something you would almost get criticized just for the fact that you've chosen such a material as a main feature for such an infrastructure.
Allow me to, maybe a bit far-fetched connection, but might it be because these projects are in the end too metropolitan for a country as provincial as that?
Yeah, that's one another issue that we are facing. We're facing our interest is really based. Remember, we had this discussion about metropolitan, non-metropolitan, say, countryside architecture and metropolitan architecture. Of course, due to the fact of the cultural background and the history of Switzerland, we tend, and of course, this obsession for the object and the nice concrete and so on, we tend to be really aside of that. And that's, I would say, this is not a plan, I would say, like something that we wanted to have, like almost as exotic. This is really for a natural interest that we have for metropolitan areas and a context that is more problematic than the sheer contemplation of the object. And in that sense, I think we tend to stand out, as much as it is vanity to say that, we stand out in the cultural, let's say, landscape of architecture in Switzerland.
But all of a sudden, I'm very fascinated because, I mean, somehow you confirm that, and I think that's also what we start to think in the studio, and I don't know why, that you build something out of steel, and somehow you can say, I don't know why, it's metropolitan. Huh?
It has something to
but
it,
why?
Yeah.
I mean, it's a kind of a strange thing. I mean, why would that be metropolitan? I somehow think...
Yeah, it's true, but it hasn't always been true.
Uh-huh.
I think that the pre-war condition is something else. The post-war condition, of course, insists on that. And, of course, there is, of course, antecedent in the 19th century with the Industrial Revolution and so on.
But
this history of building, of this ambition of building for 150 years, 200 years, and so the massivity of our cities, or if you look at Paris, it's an ambivalent feature, right? It's an ambivalent feeling also, as much as you are when you're in London also, this... But it was for a long time, steel has been used mainly as an infrastructural material because it's easy to cope with. The assembly is extremely rapid also, it can be changed and so on. But not so much for dwelling because it didn't cope with this idea of permanence and warmth and so on. It's a very, we constantly get the same kind of remarks about our architecture. People come and say, well, it's cold. But it is something, first of all, there is no such thing as cold architecture to warm architecture. There is no, even in history of art, there is no such thing as a warm color to a cold color. This is just rhetoric. Red is not warmer than blue. Of course, it appears in the theory as a warm color and, you know, and a cold color. It doesn't mean anything. And I'm fine with this critic because I don't want to build a warm city. I want to be, you know, the city is, I don't know, someone said this, a very famous one, perhaps you remember the name. He said, I don't want to build a comfortable city. I want a city that provides me with the necessary features of a city. I am comfortable.
Yeah, but we were during lunch talking exactly about that comment. I mean, not this comment.
No.
But that's I mean, what Christoph was somehow defining.
Yeah.
As metropolitan.
And that's my, let's say, I would describe my ideal city, or let's say the city I would like to build, or partly contribute to, was this kind of a city. Not a warm city, not a city that speaks about icons or anything like this, but provides the people the minimum amount of features or even catalyst elements of, through architectural features that would allow life, simply life, to take place in a more efficient way, or let's say in a catalyzed way. Because when doing nothing else, and we tend to forget that, I think this is something important to say to the students, that the architecture is subordinated to life, and it's not life that is subordinated to architecture. And in that sense, I think it's a very very simple statement, but you never forget that architecture is subordinated to life and not life to architecture. And in that sense, it's always been the driving force of our architecture. Even the stadium, which seems to promote an image of exception, which is still needed. I still believe that we need some sort of an icon, and if a hockey arena does not become an icon, then what does become an icon? I mean, the winning project by Adam Caruso, not to criticize this project or anything like this, but does another box of it. It's just devoid of any sign of what is taking place in this thing. It has nothing to do with form follows function. Again, this is beyond the form follows functions. It's what is to be said through an image, through an iconography, by means of architecture. And that we are completely misunderstanding this goal between, let's say, this mediocre tendency that we have now in Switzerland to have somehow a low-profile architecture which still doesn't know or has forgotten what classicism was and so on, not able to play with the rules, but simply repeating a certain amount of features that are either legislative or common features of architecture. Between that mediocrity and the exception of the object out loud, there's nothing left. And I think this would be our responsibility as professor or as teachers also in a school to, you know, to evoke those kind of problems, to say, well, there's room between these two extremes. There's room between a mediocrity and certain, you know, copy-paste of certain elements without the knowledge of it, then we'll be critical about this, and the exuberant manifestation of exceptions. And let's say both are needed to a certain extent, but there's an enormous gap between the two, and we have to invade this space.
Absolutely. I think I should ask the students if they have a question in that connection, because I think that's hopefully what we are trying to do.
Yep.
Of course. Any questions? Please. It's your chance. Huh? I know you're afraid that he'll give you a very long answer, but I mean, I would do the same. nobody? Come on, guys.
Yes?
I just have a question. Right now you talked about the project of Caruso Sanjo with the Allianz Arena. You say it was
no, not the Allianz.
No gossip questions. Okay.
No. You said it was a box?
It's a box. It's a simple box that doesn't say anything
and
about the nature of the project. I mean, it's a box, let's say, let's be clear. I mean, as much as I like what Adam is doing or anything like this, he was really not brave enough somehow to propose something else than simply a box that was next to another box. But you see, the problem is not so much how is it going to be fulfilling the program. You know, what people understand as the program of a hockey arena. Am I going to be able to set my ass onto these stands and watch a hockey arena? Yes, you will be able to do that. Am I going to be able to, a coherent way to reach this arena while being in the center? Yes, you will be able to. Now the question goes beyond this. Our responsibility as architects goes beyond to the answering of these programmatic features. What kind of a sign are we going to give? And how is this object going to speak to the rest of the part of the town? And how much is it going to be entering into echoes with the rest of the town? And there, I'm very critical about it, because I think it does not echo the rest of the city. Not as a mimetic feature, of course not. But it does not embrace the full potential of a programmatic feature as such in a hockey arena.
But then there's this project you did in Basel, the museum.
Yeah.
And actually, when you see the images, you
yeah.
you see.
You're right to point out to this. Yeah. No, you're right to point out.
Even you have another Lincoln in the roof.
Yeah.
But it's just telling it's a Lincoln building, and already with the program, it's a Lincoln.
Yeah. You're right. I mean, in there, the strategy, first of all, the Basel project is another feature. But I think by saying this, you are right to a certain extent. You are absolutely right. I couple the fact that this is an object. But before it's an object, it's a machine. And it's the most machinic project we've ever developed in
Basel. And you didn't show it. What's
no, I didn't show it because let's say it's an old project. And I feel in phase to a certain extent with certain features of the project, but also I'm very critical about what image it has produced. Now, there's one thing I have to say about this project that I think it had the only proposal that was meaningful for the city when it comes to urban issues, that is, how to link the old city with the new cities and so on, what was built in the 60s, what was built in the 80s, and this relationship with the object. It was almost like there was no other course of action. And the action that was chosen by Kirsten Gunther-Bein, we had... also considered that. It was funny when we discussed with Christoph and Emmanuel about this project, they said at first we started with an object like you did and we ended up with this repeating or let's say this new manifestation of a 19th century house that was set before on the plot. And we thought we did exactly the opposite. We started with this solution and then implemented the object. And the jury saw that. It's a complementary answer to what Kristen Badran had done. But before it is this, I would say the main feature of the project, which I would still defend, is that the museum is a machine. And the museum is really nothing else than a machine. There are machines everywhere. Mm-hmm. And it is staged in a very very pragmatic way, but also where architecture can become really a stage of something, staging the machine. Not only as a deal, as a way to, for example, link only let's say, several parts of the programs, but also to separate the programs. For example, there's a lift, if you know the project, there's a huge freight lift that, of course, connects to the different parts of the program, but could also, in a very, very ambivalent way of dealing with this feature, could also separate the programs. So as much as we want to consider the freight lift as a connecting feature, as Rems described it many times during this text, we consider the lift also as a separating feature, which is new, which is something that is never being used when it comes to a freight lift. So more to that, you're right, I'm being critical about this, but I'm ready also to be critical about projects we've done earlier. In our career, and in a certain way, I would totally agree with you.
No, I'm sorry, because if there's somebody else wants to ask another question, first, please go ahead. I don't want to stop you guys talking to our guest. Is there another question?
I guess one last project you were presenting.
Yeah.
You said it's the most metropolitan about it is that you interact with the city with these connections. And not that you were in a new type museum, but the connection. Would you say this is a very metropolitan condition to interact with the city?
Well, by dealing with infrastructures and linking the north and the south in the most efficient way and staging it, it's not just, you see, I think there's always, there cannot be a misunderstanding. It's not only about implementing features that will allow a better performative aspect. It's always coped to the idea of this performative aspect being linked also to a new image of the city. And in this case, it's the most metropolitan project I presented here because it's obviously set in the center of a city, and some of the others are either set onto a VI compound or on the compound, an official compound, which is like a pseudo-metropolitan condition of the city. But in this case, we were facing with the largest infrastructural building there is in Lausanne, which is the main station. It could not become anything else than infrastructural. And I would insist again, disappointingly enough, I think nowadays, Lausanne has chosen not to build this infrastructure, but to build, I'm not talking about our project, but to build a series of objects. And this is, I think, a witness of our time, and we as a profession are unable to promote these conditions because we are part of the game, and people are not resisting to that kind of a tendency to promote objects instead of promoting really what makes and builds up the city itself, that is the infrastructure. You have to realize that infrastructure is the first thing to disappear in a case of war. So first thing you attack in a case of war, in an event of war, but it's also the last thing that disappears. If you look at the images of Mayence or Mainz or Dresden after the war, you realize that everything is gone except for the infrastructure. So this contradiction between the first to be bombed, the last one to disappear, the most necessary features of a city being developed within the infrastructure, I think is an interesting point to make. and also for our city. But of course, again, as much as Switzerland is being built up onto infrastructures and infrastructure interconnections, it's not something we consider as a main feature of the Swiss architecture. For obvious reasons, look at how, you know, the generation that precedes us, they've only been doing objects, and their interest for infrastructures and, let's say, also programmatic performance is completely devoid of any features.
But it seems to be, though, that your strategy often, I'm not saying always, yes, is to build, say, objects or pseudo-objects, yes, which carry in them the desire to be infrastructure,
yeah,
which, yeah, I think is perfectly, yeah, legitimate. Yeah. That's, yeah, the trick in which you will turn your, I would say, your project potent in the discourse,
yeah,
even though you're,
yeah,
doing,
yeah,
architecture.
Yeah, of course there is an added value to what the infrastructure is, naturally, mm-hmm, speaking. You know, like, mm-hmm, there needs to be something architectural about it. In other words, but it's not, I don't think, this is really becoming on how to cope performative aspects with the consequences to an image. For example, mm-hmm, in the stadium, it's not that we chose this image and we thought, oh, this is going to be the stadium. It became afterwards, of course, some sort of a way to deal with investigating what the programs and the performance, yeah, would act within such a form, which is almost a didactic way of dealing with architecture, but also at the same time, being certain that this image, whether it would be confirmed by the performative aspect of its form, morphology, and then it has been confirmed, because we think it's a very efficient stadium, extremely small footprint, very, mm-hmm, representative space, it deals with all the performative aspect, doesn't only need to be on the level of how it copes with certain needs, primary needs, but how also there's a need in the image, in a city, for a certain kind of an image in order to promote a certain understanding of what our cities are. I'm very much in favor of a certain amount of milestones within homogeneous a tissue. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
No, definitely. I think we do. Now, if you... I mean, a very last question, comment, yeah, from my side. I'm using you also a little bit, eh? Yeah. François, in the logic of the studio. But you were just talking about the perspective or the photo collage or image of the stadium. We had here Philippe Schwerer also,
yeah,
passing by because he's teaching here. Actually, most of our students are also,
yeah,
following him. Very nice guy. And he understood, I mean, also to you that, I mean, he often works a bit with you or collaborates, or you debate at least the images you're making. It brought me to the question, how do you see the way your perspectives or your photo collages, how do they work, in the sense that they seem to be a combination of a reference and a real image, I mean, a very specific status they have, right? Of which I can imagine in some competitions, I'm quite sure, people who have to judge the image are totally confused because they don't know.
Absolutely. But that's something you point out to something. That, for example, for common work with Philippe Schelling.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I'll give you one anecdote regarding, for example, we go back in time.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, he's a friend of ours, and he's a very talented person. There's no doubt about this. And then when we did this project for the museum, the last project we saw, I remember a reaction, which is typical of today's reaction of graphists and stuff like this. He said, oh, François, he called me once in the middle of the night and said, François, should I build the Uffizis in 3D? And I said, Philip, there's something you completely misunderstood. We are not aiming at the quality of the, even the fact that we use an image that it was taken, a picture was taken in the 30s, is an intention. We want this grain. We want this to be clearly a reference image from the past. Why? Because we need one dimension we never have when we produce images nowadays, is this dimension of time. We want to inscribe the project into time. The irony now is the following one. When we came in, we also worked with him for the images of the stadium in Zurich. And he did more or less the same thing. He took over this reference image and then he added the pink sky, because it was sunset, they had a few people passing by, and then he rounded the angles and so on. And then he sent me the image. We had worked without telling me anything for 3 days on this image. And I said, Philip, I don't understand what you've done. He said, but you don't understand. This is really what I do. I said, but I give you an image with high resolution of a document you have nothing to do about. And you were for 4 days and you send me a sunset with half-transparent top models and the commercials. He said, but we have a problem with that. We're taking a picture, we're borrowing a picture, we're not dealing, and we're doing anything with it. It's not true. We're dealing with something. We erased some parts, we implemented new features, and so on. But we said we want to keep this. We even left the Arctic platform onto the sea because it was made of ice. It's an Arctic platform that is half of the year it's set into the sea, and there's ice around, which what could be more beautiful than to depict an ice hockey arena. Everything is steel, ice, cold, and so on. It's perfect. Now, the irony of it is that juries, when they look at renderings, they totally trust them. They go to a movie, they go to Jurassic Park, and they're going to watch the movie. You know, I accept. There's a very funny anecdote about this. I'll tell you the anecdote. But when they see an object that is built, they panic. So they're like, it can't be true. That can't be this. Yeah, it's built, but it can't be true. They don't trust it. So as soon as there is a discrepancy between technical drawings, let's say scale representations, and images, because we want to set images at another level of the illustration, which you have understood now, that brings another understanding, feeds the project from another side, no one would say Picasso produces illustrations. Picasso produces images, because they're readable from all sides. That's the quality of an image. And then I heard yesterday, to close the circle, I heard yesterday an interview by Jean-Luc Godard, and he said he was referring to a scientist who had developed, I think, a physicist in the early 20th century who had developed a certain relationship with relativity at the same time as Einstein did and so on. And he said, well, then I'm going to watch a movie, and he went to a movie, which is a Mankiewicz movie, and he says, he mentioned the fact, no, he was a scientist that worked on quantum physics. So he was one of the first ones to actually understand. In quantum physics, you have to be able to accept that I'm here at the same time. If you're not part of this imaginative process, you won't be able to understand quantum physics. And he said, well, then, here's the question when I go to a movies. Watch this Mankiewicz movies, and in this Mankiewicz movie, there's a scene where a train has to overcome a huge cliff through a bridge. And then he says the following thing, you know, you see the train coming onto the bridge, and then the bridge starts collapsing while the train is still on it. And at the end of the scene, there is the hero, he's calling a lady a blonde, and says, come, I'm going to save you, and he grabs her hand, and basically they reach the locomotive before the train really crumbles down. And the scientist says, well, there are three things I can believe in. First one, this scene with the train there, yeah, I can see the trick behind. It's a fake background, it's not true. But hey, I paid my ticket, I believe. Alright? And then the bridge collapsed, and so I still have a hard time, but what the hell, you know? I'm ready to believe in it. And then this hero saving the blonde, why not? But I mean, does it really make sense? But for the sake of the $15, I believe in it. Now, there's something I really don't believe a second, is that there was a camera at time T able to film this. That's the scientific process. Now, we're facing same kind of issues nowadays with representation, I think, in architecture. Is that we believe, no matter what we're given, you know, no matter where the lies come from, if it's appealing and can be sold to the press, to the media, everyone will accept it. As soon as it tries to trigger a reflection about the quality of our cities or the conditions of our cities, no one wants to speak about it anymore. And especially not if there is a dimension which is always obliterated from any kind of layout, which is that of time. That's it. Thank you.